Hello and welcome to the show. Property development stories never get old, because with every project, there's a new set of rules and new lessons learned.
Absolutely, Tommy. With property, every day is a school day. Now, the best way to start is by doing your homework, and the best place to start could well be at the auction house. Well, those who buy regularly at auction know the tricks of the trade, but they're no secrets. Do your research, try and view the property, and definitely read that legal pack.
Well, it sounds simple, but that's not always the case. And will today's buyers be sticking with their magic formula? Let's take a look and see what's coming up in the show.
In Derby, Dion's after more space in the box. Box bedroom, that is.
Move this wall slightly this way to give yourself another yard in this bedroom.
Tommy's tickled pink by some of the features in this house in Stoke.
Well, haven't seen a bathroom like this for some time.
And he's knocking it out of the park at a shop in Margate.
Yeah, everything's been cladded out.
All these properties have been sold at auction, and we'll find out who bought them and what they paid for them when they went under the hammer.
You bought it. Well done. Thank you.
First to the city of Derby. It grew rapidly in the industrial era and gained city status in 1977. With the arrival of the railways in the 19th century, Derby became a centre of the British rail industry. Today's property is perfectly located for the nearby amenities, schools and transport links.
We are not too far away from the centre of Derby, and the university is close by too. So if you are looking for a property to buy, this could be the one for you. Here we are. It is a mid-terrace house. It's got two beds and had a guide price of £55,000 plus when it went to auction. Let's get inside and have a look. OK, as soon as you come in here, the size of the room hits you, which is fine. I expected it to be this size, but I can see there's a bit of smoke damage. I can see that ceiling back in the day, it should be cream or it should be white, but it's not. I can see some cracks as well. It should be a lot brighter in here because you've got a nice big double glazed window. You've got a decent looking fireplace there too. Whether you'd want to keep it, that's personal choice. But yeah, I can see smoke damage and a few cracks. And I can see more smoke damage here as you come across from the first reception room into the second reception room. Evidence of a few more cracks as well above the window. This is a layout that I would expect to see in a house like this. Stairs are in the corner going to the bedrooms, and you come down a step into the kitchen. There's not much of a kitchen in here, but there's enough space in here to create a nice enough kitchen. Yes, it would be a bit snug, but I wouldn't expect a kitchen any bigger than this. The two reception rooms are good sizes. You'd be able to get a good sofa in the front, maybe a sofa in here. Choose what you want as your, what we would call a front room and a lounge. Could make it a dining room. It's your choice. The layout works for me, needs a bit of work, and there's a few cracks.
The cracks may or may not be something to worry about, but best to consult a structural engineer.
OK, two bedrooms upstairs. We've got one to the left and we've got the one to the right. This is the front bedroom. This is the master bedroom. It's a good-sized room in a lovely shade of pink. It's not my colour, but it might work for some other people. I can't see any central heating at all in the whole of this house, downstairs and upstairs. There's a storage heater there, up a step, and then you come into the second bedroom. Now, this would have been one bedroom back in the day, but somebody has tried to put a partition wall in here, which is a good idea and the right thing to do, so that when you want to go to the toilet, you don't have to go through this bedroom and annoy your sister or your brother. And even worse, your mum or your dad, because you would get in trouble. But it just seems that they've made this corridor so big. It might be building regs, I would double check that, but if you can, be nice to sort of move this wall slightly this way to give yourself another yard in this bedroom. There are a few cracks in here. If you follow me into here, I can see more cracks over the window there. There's some cracks above the chimney breast as well. Yeah, this room does feel a little bit tight. If you could nick into the yard, I think it would work. Move that wall that way. Yeah, no central heating in this property. I'd always get the electrics checked. Obviously, you've got to get the cracks checked out as well. That said, there's nothing really alarming me. It's just, do your research and make sure you do things in the right order. Cracks first.
There are a few bits and pieces to sort out in this house, but there's plenty of space to play around with, meaning it has lots of potential. The research needed here continues to the outside and the alleyway to the back of the property. If you have a shared access like this one, it's always worth checking if there's a fly-in freehold in place. This means part of your house or your neighbour's may be overhanging the passageway. This sometimes makes it harder to get a mortgage, so do your homework.
So we do have a bit of back garden. It is, well, when I say back garden, you could quite easily call it a jungle because it's totally overgrown. You can't really see how much space you've got. I do know that just beyond this tree here, which is quite big, is where the border ends. Yeah, you need to do a bit of work out here, but what you have got is outside space, and you could quite easily kick a ball about in here. That's about my distance, I think.
A potentially great garden for the kids.
Because he's football crazy, he's football man.
And a certain ex-professional footballer too, it would seem. Pitching up now is an expert from the auction house that sold the property. We asked him along to give us his thoughts on this two-bed terrace.
Yeah, it needs some money spending on it. I think really where it sits at the moment is you could let it out as a room-by-room basis for students or renovate it to attract the first-time buyer market.
Letting out each room individually may fall under the term of a house of multiple occupation, or HMO, and would have to comply with a local authority's regulations on things such as room sizes, fire safety and security. But for investors, it's normally a way of getting a higher return. So what would the difference be in rental income?
For the normal open market, you're probably talking around about £600 per calendar month. For the student market, these kind of HMO-style properties, you're probably talking in the region of £950 to £1,000 per calendar month.
That's a sizeable difference and worth the effort if you're happy managing multiple tenants. What about a simple resale on this house, guided at £55,000?
I think once the new owner's finished works to it, in my opinion, you're probably going to sell for around £140,000.
As auction properties go, this should be pretty straightforward. There's not an awful lot of work in there that needs to be done to bring this place back to its former glory. And I don't think you'd need a huge budget either. But what I would do, first and foremost, is get those cracks checked out by a professional. Let's find out who wanted to take this on when it went under the hammer.
This lot was part of a remote auction with bids taking place online.
Yes, we are.
The successful bid of £119,000 was made by Ellis. This is his third property project, and he hopes to venture further into the world of property development. He met Dion to tell him his plans.
Ellis, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too, Dion.
Well, I'm going to ask you a question. It might come across rude, but how old are you?
I'm 24.
24 years old, and you've started out on this journey already. Number three for you, so you're finding your feet and
yeah.
Are you finding it easier now you've done more?
I'm finding it easier to sort of negotiate, obviously find the right people to jump on the jobs and things. So it's going great, yeah.
Is this your venture, or is there more than you on this venture? Have you got partners or family, friends that are helping?
I've got some investors and sort of business people that are sort of helping me out with this one. So, I guess I'm quite lucky to do this, very lucky, but I'm not going to let them down at any point. So I'm really, really
good man.
Focusing on this,
good
yeah.
Man. You've got yourself a project to be getting on with. Are you happy with it?
Yeah, I'm really happy with this property. It's a really nice place.
And yeah?
Yeah, looking forward to it.
Were you looking for this kind of property?
Yeah, it was, there's a lot of student lets around this area, so we're really trying to focus on the HMO aspect of it and really, you know, trying to tap into that sort of market.
Bedroom-wise, how many are we talking?
So at the moment it's a two, but we're going to change it into a three. So
okay.
Convert it into a three-bedroom.
So the third bedroom will be?
In the lounge.
In the lounge. Two upstairs?
Two upstairs, yes.
One in the lounge?
Yes, and separate that so it's like a brand-new hallway that's coming through.
Yeah, we don't need to be awkward, do we?
No.
You don't want to go in somebody's bedroom from the front door.
No. No, I wouldn't want that.
So you come in the front door, there'll be a hallway,
okay.
And there'll be a separate door into that front bedroom, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Perfect. What will this be?
This will be a dining communal area.
Okay.
Sort of space.
Kitchen?
Kitchen, it's just going to stay as it is, just refurb it.
Now, I came in here and the first thing I seen was a little bit of smoke damage. I can't see any kind of fire damage, but I can see smoke damage. Any idea where that's come from?
So I noticed that as well. I looked around. I think at the moment we're just going to sort it out and get the right people in to investigate that.
Gotcha.
But, I noticed that as well.
Yeah, it makes it kind of dark, doesn't it?
It does.
I have seen a couple of cracks as well. Are you worried about the cracks in the building?
Not too worried. We had a structural surveyor come in and he's going to give us sort of a certificate on what needs to be done. So we've already done that with the damp proofing as well. So in terms of, getting the work done, we're going to start fairly soon.
Okay. Back garden, I've got to see half of the back garden. I've not seen the back half yet, because I can't get to it. Is that your genre? Is that something you're going to get involved in?
No, I'm not going to get involved.
You don't get your hands dirty, do you?
No, I don't. I won't get my hands involved, but definitely we'll do a patio, definitely we'll sort it out and make it look fresh as well, clean. It's very important.
Ellis may not be getting his own hands dirty, but he's confident in the team he's assembled. He is aiming to get the work done with a budget of £30,000 within a timescale of 4 to 5 months. Ideally, he'd like to come in under budget and wants to take his time with this project to make sure it's perfect.
And who's going to do the work on this place?
So I've got a team. I've got an electrician, plumber, and then a handyman who just does everything. So I've really got some good guys that I've built over different properties. And I'm hoping it's going to look great.
Okay, so what kind of finish do we go for? Is it your eye or...?
Yeah, it's my eye, sort of modern, something that looks sleek, very, very... Just competitive on this market, especially on this street. So I'm really trying to make it stand out.
Gotcha. Excited by this one?
Yeah, I'm looking forward to this one.
Should definitely. Be good, eh?
Yeah,
should
I'm going to be... Yeah.
This is your third one. I can't wait to see you when you've done your fourth and your fifth and your sixth. Good luck.
Thank you.
Right, Ellis, 24 years old, and he's started his own property portfolio in a good area that's close to the city centre and close to the university. That, to me, says a sustainable business model. You can find out how Ellis gets on later in the programme.
We're in Hanley, the commercial hub of Stoke-on-Trent. The town was once an important mining centre, and Hanley's Deep Pit was the deepest mining pit in North Staffordshire. Now the site has been converted into the picturesque Central Forest Park, and not too far away is where we'll find our next lot.
Today, I'm in Hanley, one of the six towns that make up the city of Stoke-on-Trent. So what am I here to see? Something that's very popular with homes under the hammer, and that's a two-bedroom mid-terrace with a guide price of £48,000. So why don't we take a look inside and see what you're going to get for your money. A little bit of a squeeze for a big boat to get in that front door. Right, oh, this is a lot of work done to it already. The central staircase, that's the original position for the staircase. And they've taken the walls out and opened it all up and left it as a feature in the middle of the room. But if you're going to do that, you'd be better off to take the staircase out, turn it round and run it down this wall, put a feature handrail and spindles down and make this into the centrepiece for the room. And that gives you proper access off a landing into the bedrooms. So you gain a bit of space upstairs. Generally, it's in pretty good order, but it needs a bit of TLC. But other than that, it's not too bad. It's pretty straight. That's a bit ominous because the chimney breast is missing from there, but it doesn't look like there are any RSJs, rolled steel joists, taking the weight. And you've got 3 to 5 tonne above there because you've got the chimney breast above it. Then you've got the chimney stack that goes up through the loft space and outside. I'm not too happy with that because it looks like it's just been cut off and plastered up. What's holding it up? You wouldn't want that coming down in the middle of the night. Not if your bed was up against it anyway, that's for sure. So I'll have to check it out.
There's definitely cause for concern with the chimney, but the lounge's second chimney is luckily still intact. It's a spacious living area with the potential for moving the staircase to open it up even more. It's in need of a good refresh, however, and although there's central heating throughout, the property will probably need to have a rewire and a replumb.
Here we have a very standard type of galley kitchen. It's all there, the units are still there and they're okay, a little bit of damage, but it's all a bit tired and it could probably do with a slight reconfiguration and then refit it out as new. And to be honest, I do think that the wooden panelling and the pink tiles are past their sell-by date.
Yes, with a little attention and a bit of TLC, the kitchen will be good as new. But what about the rest of the property?
Well, I haven't seen a bathroom like this for some time. It's a sort of peach colour, and it's got gold-plated taps and mixers and accessories. Really, this needs to all be ripped out, get rid of your peach melbas and gold taps and everything. Tiles are a bit dated on the walls. Strip it all back to the walls, redo it, nice and contemporary, and get it all working properly and a better use of the space. See you some other day, somewhere else. Just pay my respects to say goodbye to all this stuff before it disappears forever. Sticking a bit. That's because the timber, the door, has actually swollen a bit and that's why it's sticking. So that'd have to be taken off, shaved down with a plane and put back on. Now, what we've got here, we've got a long pathway, which is common with these types of houses, but it can be turned into something nice. You could pick up all these slabs and relay them, and then you come out into your garden and you walk down your newly laid paving floor, and then what we've got here? So, what's in here now? Stuff. Rubbish. There's even a rubbish bin in there. So, that needs to be ripped right out, and then the space that that creates, you could turn into a fabulous courtyard garden. I mean, we know how valuable it is to have a little bit of outside space. You know, very important that there's social space for you, friends, and the family.
As with the rest of the property, the back garden needs some sprucing up. But by removing the shed, and with a bit of hard work, it could be transformed into an appealing courtyard. So the downstairs all needs a bit of attention. But what about the upstairs?
Oh, it's a great size double bedroom, the second one there. And this is a good size bedroom. But that's what I was worried about. And it is here. The chimney breast is still in place. Now, that should be supported all the way down to the ground floor. And if you take out a chimney breast, then you have to support whatever's left by putting in a supporting panel for it. There's no evidence that that's the case down below. So that needs opening up and finding out whether it is properly supported, because if it's not, as I said, it could be anywhere between 3 and 5 tonnes in that. And if that was to go, the repercussions could be severe. We're looking around the rest of the room. There's nothing much to do except redecorate. But that must be sorted as a matter of urgency.
As feared, the chimney stack is still in the upstairs bedroom, so we'll need a professional to examine it and see if the correct support has been installed. If not, the work needs to be done to make it safe. But what will a local estate agent make of this two-bed mid-terrace, guided at £48,000? We've invited one along to get his thoughts.
First impressions of the property, it's in need of full refurbishment. You can see, though, in the past, the property has had money spent on it. But if I was to refurbish the property and bring it up to a modern standard, I would be looking at putting in a new kitchen, new bathroom, replastering, new carpets, rewiring, and a new central heating system.
And what does the agent think it will cost to bring the property up to a modern standard?
If you were to bring the property up to a current modern standard, I would anticipate you'd be looking to spend in the region of £20,000 to £30,000.
And once all this has been done, what could you expect to make on today's market?
Once the property has been renovated to a good standard, I would recommend a rental figure in the region of £550 per calendar month. On the resale market, I would suggest a figure of £95,000 to £100,000.
Well, this is a typically solid Stoke house. Mid-terrace, two-bedroom, that needs all the usual things. Kitchen, bathroom, rewire, replumb, new windows. But it could be made to look fabulous. There is, however, one serious point that must be addressed, that the chimney breast and the chimney stack have been properly supported strength-wise. But with that done and it all redecorated, this could turn out to be a lovely home for someone. Let's see who fancied the challenge when it went under the hammer.
This lot was part of a remote auction with bids taking place online.
Sold.
The successful bid of £53,000 was made by Lee, a property developer who has been on the show three times before. We last saw him in 2019 at a house he didn't make many changes to at all.
I could have spent money on the kitchen, the bathroom, the carpets. I could have got carried away. But I found tenants who like the property as it is, who can put their own touch on it and can be happy here.
But will he have to work a bit harder at this latest addition to his rental portfolio?
Well, Lee, it's good to meet you. I hear that you're an old hand at this, but you haven't been on it for about 4 years.
That's right, Tommy, I'm back.
Is there any reason why you've had this holiday?
That's another story. I've done houses, but it's been more in the process of having my first child, buying another house, and all the emotion that goes with that. I'm back to buying houses.
Ah, right. What are you intending to do with this house? Is it for rental or for flipping and selling? Or?
Yeah, so when you look around the property, you'll see there's a lot to do in terms of making it ready for resale. In terms of rental, there isn't that much you've got to do. You've got to get your electrical certificate, your gas safe, your EPC to the right rating. Once it's safe, I can get a tenant in, and the rental demand is so strong, I wouldn't fear not finding a tenant.
And what sort of timescale are you allocated for this property?
There should be a tenancy within 3 months.
Yeah, and the budget?
So I wouldn't want to spend about another 12.
Are you going to do anything to the outside space?
The outside space just needs clearing. With new doors and windows, it'll make it 100% secure. Maybe a lick of paint.
Right, and at the bottom, you've got an area which has got that big old green shed, which is just full of rubbish. If you took that out, you could have a nice little patio area there, but it would improve the value of the property considerably.
The property's not going down for resale. The property's going down for remortgage. It's more about getting the property up to date, habitable, maintenance-free, and on to the next.
I understand all that. You prefer your rentals to be simple rather than
low
complex.
Low maintenance, yeah.
That brings me to the chimney breast.
In honesty, I didn't see that. I've seen that on entry today. Yes, it needs taken care of. Yes, it will be taken care of. It's something I've done before by choice, not through necessity. This time, it'll be necessity.
Well, I'm looking forward to seeing the end result because I think I'm going to be pleasantly surprised that it's going to be better than my expectations.
I think you're right. I'll make sure I don't get carried away, but I'm going to do everything that needs doing. I'll come in under budget, in on the 3-month timescale. Come on back and see what I can do.
Oh, well, I'm looking forward to it. All I can do is wish you the best of luck.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Lee, what a character. Well, he certainly looks like a man with a plan. And you have to respect his plan because he's very experienced and he's got quite a portfolio of property around him. So he's been through the mill and he knows exactly what he has to do to get this place ready. But will he get the whole job done on budget and will he get it done in the timescale that he expects to get it finished? Well, you can find out exactly how he does later in the show.
Coming up, Tommy's taking climbing the property ladder a bit too literally.
A lot of work to be done to make it work, but an interesting project.
And find out if Lee's had to step up his budget.
I was setting a window fitter on, a joiner on, electrician on. They all cost loads of money.
Time to go back to Derby, where Dion saw a two-bed mid-terrace that wasn't giving him the kind of warm welcome he was looking for.
As soon as you come in here, the size of the room hits you, which is fine. I expected it to be this size, but I can see there's a bit of smoke damage. I can see that ceiling back in the day, it should be cream or it should be white, but it's not. I can see some cracks as well. It should be a lot brighter in here because you've got a nice big double glazed window. You've got a decent looking fireplace there too. Whether you'd want to keep it, that's personal choice. But yeah, I can see smoke damage and a few cracks.
But once those issues were remedied, then it could be a cracking investment. Which is just what 24-year-old Ellis thought. This was his third development in his young career, and he knew the area well.
Were you looking for this kind of property?
Yeah, it was, well, there's a lot of student lets around this area, so we're really trying to focus on the HMO aspect of it.
Bedroom-wise, how many are we talking?
So at the moment it's a two, but we're going to change it into a three, so convert it into a three-bedroom.
So the third bedroom will be...?
In the lounge.
In the lounge. Main. Two upstairs?
Two upstairs, yes.
One in the lounge?
Yeah, and separate that so it's like a brand-new hallway that's coming through.
Yeah, we don't need to be awkward, do we?
No.
We don't want to go in somebody's bedroom from the front door.
No.
Ellis had a solid plan and had set up his team of regular builders with a budget of 30 grand. He hoped all the work could be completed in a maximum of 5 months. But we're heading back 13 months later, so it's behind schedule. But is it now ready to rent out? They've done it. Ellis has added a partition wall on entry as planned to enable a bedroom in what was the lounge. The property has had central heating installed, as well as new flooring throughout, and it's been replastered. The kitchen has been completely replaced. And the same can be said for the upstairs bathroom, which has been decked out with modern fixtures and fittings. The two bedrooms have also been given a makeover. But Ellis didn't stop there. He's also created a fourth bedroom by adding stairs and converting the loft space. It's even got an ensuite shower room. Ellis really is full of surprises.
When it came to converting the loft, we did have to get a structural engineered plan, so that allowed us to look at the safety and look at the mechanics. Once we'd done that, we had to create a partition wall in the third bedroom and also close off a wall in the second bedroom. That gave us access to build a staircase into the loft, and in there we just kind of redesigned it, and I feel like anyone that's going to be living there will be happy to move in.
They've definitely maximised the space for shared occupancy. And when Ellis and his team looked into the paperwork required for an HMO, they were pleasantly surprised.
After looking at the local authorities' policies regarding HMOs in this area, we actually found out that the minimum requirement for a HMO licence is 5 bedrooms. So we just fall short under that licence, but it still allows us to create as a multi-let without having to go through an application.
That did mean some red tape was skipped over, but Ellis has made sure the rooms have their own locks for security, and he will fully furnish each one and the reception area, hoping to let this out to students attending the nearby universities. Out in the back garden, the area that was completely overgrown is now a lovely communal seating area, perfect for socialising. But what did he do about the smoke damage and those cracks throughout the building?
So when it came to the smoke damage and the cracks, we just had to have someone come and inspect it. After looking at it, it wasn't anything to do with the structure of the property, but rather it was just the old plasterboards in the ceilings. So we just had to remove it, get it all back to brick. After that, we had some new plasterboards put in, and that allowed us to skim over it nicely and just get a nice finish on the walls.
It's taken Ellis longer than he wanted to complete the work here, although the loft conversion wasn't in his original plan. So has that meant he's had to amend his 30 grand budget?
We've gone over around 5 grand, so bringing us to 35K. It's been worth it. I'm just here for the rental and I'm not really looking to sell at any point.
Well, let's see if the figures add up. The total investment here now sits at £154,000. We've asked along an expert from the auction house for his thoughts on the renovation.
Wow, what a surprise. I have seen this house before, and what a considerable change there is since the last time I was here. I think the layout really has made the best use of the space that was available. I think it was a great use of space to passage the hallway to create a bedroom from what was the front reception room. It was also a good idea to have converted the attic room into a bedroom. I think I would want to make sure that the staircase was compliant with building regulations, and I would certainly feel happier seeing a handrail in place for that staircase.
Ellis has already had an offer of over £200,000 for the house, which would give him a pre-tax profit of at least £46,000. However, Ellis did not accept, as this was always a long-term project for him and his investors. So what kind of rental return should he expect?
I would suggest that each room would let for £100 per week, inclusive of utilities. That would give you, if fully let, an income of £20,800 per year.
I think we could definitely do better. I've had a chat with some of the estate agents, and I think the three rooms could go for £550 per month, and then the loft room can go for £650. And it's brand new, so I don't see any trouble in getting that rent.
Ellis's figures for the rooms would mean, fully let, the house would bring in a yearly sum of £27,600, minus, of course, the costs of inclusive bills and utilities. This is just the third property for the young developer, but does he plan on expanding even more?
So what's next on the cards is to definitely work on some other projects that I've got lined up, but I'm also going to take some rest for now. I need a break.
To Margate in Kent now, and this traditional seaside town has long been a draw for Londoners who wanted a day out on the coast. And now, with the addition of the Turner Contemporary Gallery, it's become a cultural draw as well. But Tommy's not here for the sand or the sculptures, but for a stroll around the shops.
I'm in a pedestrianised area, right at the heart of the town centre. So it has all the amenities you could possibly need at your fingertips. And it sounds like an interesting auction like this one, because on the ground floor, it's a commercial retail space with two stories above. It had a guide price of £180,000, and there's a lot to see, so I better get started. Oh, well, it's a good-sized commercial space, ideal for retail. Yeah, everything's been cladded out. So there's two ways you could look at this. If it were me, as a professional builder, I'd strip it right back to the original brickwork so you know what's there. But you could just give this a light touch, repair the ceiling, because it's a full ceiling, and redecorate this through, give it a good clean, and you'd have a retail centre ready to go. And out here, there's a WC at the back, there's a small kitchen, and there's an office. Yeah, so there ain't that much to do, really, if you want to give it a light touch. Let's take a look upstairs now, and this seems to be the access to the upper floors. We might have to have a little chat about it. This is interesting. A window bricked up, a big wide corridor. Not a very good use of the space.
But if that staircase was to be removed, this then could make a nice fitted kitchen with natural light coming from that window and open that one up again. Yeah. Again, that's an interesting staircase up to the next floor. We'll investigate that in a minute. So, yeah, that's a nice, decent-sized room. But you've got this big, wide corridor, and if this was to be reduced by 3 foot, then that room could use that space, and that'd be 3 foot wider. Yeah, that's what I think about, reconfiguring everything. And this could be where the new staircase comes up into and then goes up one more to the next floor instead of using the ladder. Yeah, there'll be no need for this as a kitchenette because that's down there. So this space could be knocked through. It's only a stud wall. And you'd have a big lounge here then. Yeah, a much better use of the space. I think now we need to have a look at the next floor. Let's have a little look up here. Right, now this is what we got. We've got a big room at the front. We've got another room directly above that one here and another big room at the back. Yeah, it's a bit too dangerous to actually climb around up here at the moment, you know, so I'm going to stay on the ladder. But there's potential here to make another flat. So one on this floor, one on the floor below, and then the commercial space right at the bottom. A lot of work to be done to make it work, but an interesting project.
And to help figure it out, there's already a planning application in place to create a mixed development of a shop and 3 one-bedroom flats, which involves turning some of the commercial space to residential, with a flat on each floor. And access to those flats would be from a side passage at the rear. But is that really the best option? What does a local estate agent think?
I think if it's got planning permission in for 3 one-bedroom flats and also commercial, I think that might be a little bit over-accommodating the building. I think perhaps they might need to look at 2 flats, perhaps 2 bedrooms, rather than 3 one-beds. I think the commercial will have to stay on the ground floor.
OK, so let's put some figures on the likely returns a mixed development could bring in. Firstly, the income from a shop.
For the commercial unit here, with the state of the market, I would expect the rental to be between £6,000 and £7,000 per annum.
This building was guided at £180,000, so what returns might a one-bed flat generate?
I think if you were looking to sell them, you'd be looking up to £180,000 per flat. And if you were to rent them out, you would be looking at £800 per calendar month per unit.
This is a sizeable property, and with that comes great potential. Yes, I know there's loads of work to be done, but there is also opportunity. And this could be a great mixed residential and commercial space, which I think would be a great opportunity for someone. Let's see who agreed when it went under the hammer.
This lot was part of a remote auction with bids taking place online.
Done, it's going to be sold. Well done.
Spot on the £180,000 guide price, the successful bidders were mother and son team, Lena and Alex. And they met Tommy back in Margate to talk shop.
Well, Lena and Alex, congratulations on your auction purchase.
Thank you.
Thank you.
What was it that attracted you about this particular property?
Well, we liked that it has a shop and then there's 3 floors for residential units as well. So it's a very large property for the price.
So what do you intend to actually do with the property? If you can, you know, tell me, you know, what your plans are for it.
Well, Alex is the one who's got more plans than I have, I think.
Well, for the shop, my ex-wife is planning to make a kind of a curio shop and maybe have some taxidermy as well, stuff like that.
Oh, right.
And then we're hoping to do 3, possibly 4 one-bedroom flats in the block behind the shop. So
really?
Yeah.
That's quite an ambitious plan to have 4
residential units at the back?
Well, four would be the most we could squeeze in. We'll probably end up doing about three.
One per floor is normally the way to go.
There's some roof space up there, we're hoping, but we haven't actually put that into the council yet, so we just kind of made some measurements rather than, I don't know. I mean, we thought about it, didn't we?
Well, we'll have to see. I think we take it step by step. We get this ground floor done first.
Do you intend to strip this right back, or are you just going to do decorating job on it?
No, I think this level will be stripped right back.
Yeah, I think we're going to remove the false ceiling.
And, good idea.
Kind of get a few of the more period features exposed. There's some nice
fireplaces.
There's some nice fireplaces. There's some nice kind of beams and stuff around the place that we quite like to highlight.
Lena and Alex have done a number of properties over the last 10 years, but this will be by far their biggest property project to date. They're hoping, depending on planning permission, to have all the units let out within 6 to 8 months.
What sort of budget do you think you'll need for doing what you want to do?
I think we budgeted originally about 50,000, didn't we?
I think.
To do the whole project?
Possibly.
It's ambitious.
Alex is going to do some of the work himself, so that probably cuts the costs down a little.
Are you a builder, qualified?
Not qualified, but I've been working around the industry for about 10 years or so now, so
I can do most of the stuff.
Yeah, carpentry especially. I worked in a lumber mill. I've worked in an aluminium machining factory, so quite handy. I mean, we've kind of done this stuff for a decade or so as a family.
And as a family business,
yes.
Mum and son, who's the boss?
Depends. Where it comes to money, it's probably me, and where it comes to the work, that's Alex.
Oh, you're definitely the boss. I'm not the boss.
That's it. Yes, definitely. My mum
would always
be the
boss.
Well,
he's got to know his place, hasn't he?
Yeah. I pretend sometimes, but...
Absolutely.
Do you enjoy working together?
I think we mostly get on.
So.
Yes, I mean, we do have, obviously, you're going to have disagreements or, you know, you're obviously going to say, well, I don't think we'll do that. And the other will say, but I must do that. And, you know, there's always those sorts of things.
Yeah, so it'd be an interesting project to do. Are you excited for it?
Yes, there's a lot to think about, but yes, it should be quite an exciting time. So it's not too stressful.
I want to wish you both a great deal of luck, and I hope you get everything you want out of the property.
Thank you very much.
Alex and Lena have some property experience behind them, but this is by far the biggest task they've ever taken on. However, they do seem to work well as a team, even though there is a long road to go, starting with getting planning permission for this whole project. How will they get on? You can find out later in the show. Earlier, we saw how one property turned out, but we still have two left.
Absolutely. So how will the properties look now? And has all their time and money been well spent? Let's find out. Back to the city of Stoke again, where Tommy saw a Staffordshire classic. No, not an oat cake, but a two-bed terrace, the bread and butter of the property market here.
Needs a bit of TLC, but other than that, it's not too bad. It's pretty straight. That's a bit ominous because the chimney breast is missing from there, and you've got 3 to 5 tonne above there because you've got the chimney breast above it, then you've got the chimney stack. I'm not too happy with that because it looks like it's just been cut off and plastered up. What's holding it up? You wouldn't want that coming down in the middle of the night. Don't try to mess with me. Don't try
to bring me down. The hammer came down on this house at £53,000, and it was bought by Lee, who's a regular on the show, and was adding this to his growing portfolio of rental properties.
Getting the property up to date, habitable, maintenance-free, and on to the next.
You prefer your rentals to be simple rather than
complex. Low maintenance, yeah.
That brings me to the chimney breast.
In honesty, I didn't see that. I've seen that on entry today, Yes, it needs taken care of. Yes, it will be taken care of. It's something I've done before by choice, not through necessity. This time, it'll be necessity.
Lee hoped that he could fully renovate the property for 12 grand and have a tenant in 3 months. We're back almost 5 months later to see how he got on. And if that worrying chimney stack has been remedied. You keep me up all night, you keep me up all. It certainly has, with a steel gallows bracket to support the weight of the chimney breasts above. You keep me up all night. The floors have been levelled and the rest of downstairs has been fully modernised and given a fresh coat of white paint. The kitchen has been updated and fully rewired and replumbed.
My temperature is rising.
The classic pink bathroom suite didn't stick around either. It's a case of here be day, gone tomorrow. And upstairs has been given the same thorough refresh. With new flooring, replastered and painted walls, and a clean and simple white colour scheme that Lee has implemented in the rest of the house. And that's the way
I like it. The design of this property fits the buy-to-let model, or my buy-to-let model that I like to put on all my places. Maintenance low, so that tenancy changeovers, it's just a quick flash of paint and simple replacements of a few fittings. Easy to maintain for the tenants if they're a long-term tenant. Easy clean, and that's how I finished it, I think.
As well as the work inside, Lee's friend Jordan, who is a dab hand with a paintbrush, came round to give the gutters and walls a fresh new coat, which has made all the difference out here. But Lee also got his hands dirty.
So I'm not just the property manager on this project. It is me grafting. I'm sure Jordan, my labourer, would say different, and Danny, my plasterer, Andy, the electrician, but I have been working hard on this one. And the fact that I can get up and do my own thing and be here till 1 o'clock in the afternoon or 10 o'clock at night, the positivity comes from the freedom of this kind of role.
The works needed here were extensive, both inside and out, which might explain why Lee has taken the best part of 5 months to complete the work, rather than his original 3 month timescale.
I was setting a plaster on, an electrician on, a window fitter on, a joiner on, electrician on. They all cost loads of money, but it's okay. In the long-term game, it'll add up good. But it wasn't, they could all start on Monday. You had to fit in with their schedule. And my plasterer's a lovely guy, my electrician's a lovely guy, but they've all got other things to do as well. So it just worked in good that it's taken 5 months to get to this stage, but I haven't broke my back and no one else has either. Everyone's got paid. I'm happy with the bill, the final outcome, just about. And it just worked, this property has.
Ah, yes, the final bill. Hiring all those trades for the laundry list of work here can't have been cheap.
So my original budget of £12,000 has gone way over budget and I've hit 17. That's escalated dramatically because looking around, there's so many places where I've saved thousands of pounds, i.e. the kitchen, that was off a friend, the windows, some of them are secondhand, and it still added up to £5,000 more than I'd budgeted for.
The cost for the work has taken Lee's final spend here up to 70 grand, but has the overspend been worth it? We've asked back the estate agent who saw it the last time for their opinion.
It's a basic standard of finish. For me, it's ideal for the rental market. It's a blank canvas. Somebody can just move the furniture in. It's clean and tidy throughout. There'll be no problems finding either a buyer or a tenant.
Sounds like the options for Lee are good either way here. But has the £70,000 he's had to invest been worth the money?
If we were to put the property on the sales market, I would recommend a figure in the region of £95,000.
It would be viable for the work that I've done, but there's no way we're selling for that price.
That potential £25,000 pre-tax profit is certainly a good return, but Lee is in this for the long term. So what about the rental figure?
If we were to put the property on the rental market, I would suggest a figure in the region of £575 per calendar month.
At £575 per calendar month, I will go for that if my tenant paying £600 next week falls through.
The £600 rental that Lee is bringing in would net him a good 10% yield, which is no doubt why he wants to keep this long term. He can count this as another successful project.
Any advice to anyone watching this show and thinking, if he could do it, I can do it? It isn't as easy as it looks. You've got to have the cash flow in place from the start, and most importantly, make sure the project isn't overspent on purchase. If you get the property underpriced, you can't really go wrong.
Lee has over 20 properties in his portfolio, so has years of experience to draw on. With this new addition being complete, what's in store for the future?
There's always another deal out there, but for now, I'm prioritising me, my little boy, and life going forward.
Back to Margate now, where Tommy saw a commercial unit with two stories above. Although there wasn't a staircase to access the top floor, that didn't deter Tommy.
Let's have a little look up here. Right, now this is what we got. We've got a big room at the front. We've got another room directly above that one here, and another big room at the back. There's potential here to make another flat. So one on this floor, one on the floor below, and then the commercial space right at the bottom.
It would take a lot of work, but there was a planning application in to create three one-bedroom flats, one on each floor above the commercial unit, and one to the back, with separate access from the shop to the rear. It was bought for £180,000 by Lena and her son Alex. They'd been renovating properties together for over 10 years and planned on creating flats to rent them and the commercial space.
And as a family business, who's the boss?
Depends. Where it comes to money, it's probably me, and where it comes to the work, that's Alex.
Yeah, so it'd be an interesting project to do. Are you excited for it?
Yes, there's a lot to think about, but yes, it should be quite an exciting time. As long as it's not too stressful.
They were armed with a £50,000 budget and hoped to have all the units ready and bringing in income in 6 to 8 months. Now we've returned 8 months later. But the shop doesn't seem to be open for business. Progress has been made, though, with the addition of two skylights, which brings lots of natural light into the ground floor flat to the rear. And there's a new staircase that leads up to the other two flats. The boarded-up window in the first floor flat has been replaced with French doors. And to the front, some internal walls have been taken down, creating a larger living space. Up on the top floor, there's been more layout changes. And although this is the flat Lena and Alex have been concentrating on, it's still not finished. 'Cause I'm not ready. But there's been some happy news that could explain the delays with the work here.
Alex's sister, Katie, has just had a small baby, so that has interrupted things quite a bit, hasn't it?
It has. It's been quite difficult sometimes to balance the project and then, you know, life generally as well.
And your two boys have...
Oh, yeah, and then I've got two boys, so looking after them is a full-time job as well as doing the full-time project.
It sounds like Alex has had his hands full over the last 8 months. With that in mind, they now have a more reasonable timescale of up to a year to get everything complete and have the flats rented out, with a farm shop selling local produce on the ground floor. But before then, there's plenty of hard work ahead.
It's been mostly me, and then I've hired a friend to come in and help, and he works here a couple of days a week, and we have a laugh and we get things done a little bit faster than I would on my own.
And when we return to see the completed flats, what kind of finish can we expect?
Hopefully a quite high standard, even though I'm doing most of it myself. But we are using reclaimed materials, so everything is secondhand, pretty much, other than the tiles and things like that, which we're buying new. But we wanted to keep the kind of the style and age of the building. So we've polished some of the brickwork, we've used original features wherever possible, stuff like that, just to kind of keep in keeping with the building, really.
Does this plan of reusing materials mean that they will be able to stick to their original 50 grand budget?
Probably spent about 20,000, I would say.
Roundabout, yes. We will have an electrician coming in to put in the electrics on the top floor flat. And then he will have a look at what else needs to be done and maybe give us a price for that.
But I think we're doing well because we're not really counting our own income as factoring that into the end project. So I've probably done a lot more hours than I'm charging myself for, really.
Time to hear from the estate agent who viewed the property 8 months ago for his opinion on the work so far.
I think with this property, you could really look at doing a nice finish, something perhaps a little bit traditional, making the most of the space, which they're doing, plenty of light, which again, I've seen some skylights, so that's a big benefit. So I think they're really going about it the right way at the moment.
Their total spend here will be £230,000 if they can stick to their original budget. But is investing their money into this project going to pay off in the long run?
I think looking at the returns and the level of the standard of finish, I think you could look up to around about £500,000 for the whole thing.
Sounds quite a good to price, actually.
Yeah, that's quite a lot of money, isn't it?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
A lot more than we got the place for.
Yes, it's actually £320,000 more than they paid at auction. However, the key to maximising any profit will be sticking as close as possible to their £50,000 budget. Their plan, though, is to keep the flats and rent both them and the commercial unit on the ground floor, which the agent thinks could bring in £9,000 a year. But what about the flats?
A rental at this type of flat at the moment would be in the region of around about £600 per calendar month.
That sounds about right, yeah.
Because they're only one bedroom, aren't they? I mean, I think two bedrooms would probably go for 900 or something of that order.
If they stick to their budget of £50,000, with the shop bringing in £9,000 per year and the three flats bringing in over £21,000, Lena and Alex could be looking at an impressive 13% yield. But what are their plans once all this is over?
I think I might take a back seat in the future.
I'm hoping to do more projects, but I'm not sure which ones I will get involved in next.
We hope you enjoyed the projects today and maybe even picked up a tip or two along the way.
Yeah, we always love to inspire you and hopefully get you bidding. And don't forget to press the red button now to watch more episodes of Homes Under the Hammer, only on BBC iPlayer.